Good morning. Oh, you guys can do better than that. Good morning. There we go. That's better. Let's see what kind of announcements we have. Okay, let's just drop down. See, we have a happy anniversary for Bob and Shelley Curry, and several birthdays here. Altar flowers were given in glory of God and in honor of, I hope I'm saying your name right, Asti Hastings. Asti? Okay, I knew I wouldn't do that right. The mission basket today is for the Service Club Goodfellows Basket, Angel Tree, and Christmas bags to our community. See, I guess I don't have very many announcements this morning. They're having after church service today, right? They're having fall feast lunch and fun. Come out and have a great lunch of hibachi or hamburgers and hot dogs at Kyle and Ron Diornella's home, 1404 East, 100 North Paxton. Meat and drinks and tableware provided. Bring a side dish or dessert and some chairs. Game and pumpkin fun for all ages. And I think, Wednesday night they're having bells practice, choir practice, and nimble fingers. And we do appreciate what those ladies do. And let's see. Then, I guess we're ready for call to worship. Okay. Praise is due to God in Zion. God answers our prayers. And now we'll do hymn 507, Through It All. And I'll...
Let us turn together to our prayer of confession for this morning. It is in our bulletin. It is also on our screen. Let us pray together. O God, ever forgiving and master, take away from us, we pray, all our iniquities and the spirit of pride and arrogance. Give us humble and contrite hearts, that we may, with pure minds and hearts, enter into the Holy of Holies. Rather than relying upon your grace to do what we cannot, we seek to earn approval by works of self-righteousness. Not only do we build ourselves up, but we tear down those who do not fit our concept of what is right and good and honorable. Forgive us our judgmental ways. Convert us to true humility, that we may rely on your grace and mercy alone. Enable us to approach you with empty hands, that we might be filled. Answer these prayers we offer in Jesus' name. Let us take a moment for our own personal and silent prayer. Most gracious God, we come to you in repentance, seeking forgiveness. knowing that as we do, you are eager to forgive and eager to receive us. We give you thanks for the forgiveness we receive this day. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, amen. And our praise focus for today is His Mercy Is More, written by Matt Boswell. It's performed by Keith and Kristen Getty, sorry.
His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many. His mercy. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore, our sins, they are many. His mercy is more.
Stronger than darkness, new.
is 2 Timothy 4, 6 through 8, and 16 through 18. I'm already being poured out like, hang on a second here. I knew I'd need these. Ah, there is words on these pages. I'm already being poured out like a sacrifice to God, and the time of my death is near. I have fought the good fight, finished the race, and kept the faith. At last, the champion's wreath that is awarded for righteousness is waiting for me. The Lord who is the righteous judge is going to give it to me on that day. He's giving it not only to me, but also to all those who have set their heart on waiting for his appearance. No one took my side at my first court hearing. Everyone deserted me. I hope that God doesn't hold it against them, but the Lord stood by me and gave me strength so that the entire message would be preached through me and so all the nations could hear it. I was also rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil action and will save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and always. Amen. Gospel reading this morning is Luke 18, 9, 1 through 8. Okay. All right. Jesus told this parable to certain people who had convinced themselves that they were righteous and who looked on everyone else with disgust. Two people went up to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed about himself with these words, God, I thank you that I'm not like everyone else, crooks, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of everything I receive. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He wouldn't even lift his eyes to look toward heaven. Rather, he struck his chest and said, God, show mercy to me, a sinner. I tell you, this person went down to his home justified rather than the Pharisee. All who lift themselves up will be brought low, and those who make themselves low will be lifted up. And we have children's moment with Lisa and Tara Crumwitty.
Good morning. I'd like to tell you a brief story and then ask you a few questions about it. Is that going to be okay? I promise they'll be easy questions. Okay. There were two girls, and neither of them could play soccer. They were both awful at it. But girl number one thought she could play soccer and that she could play it well. She'd walk around talking about how she was the best soccer player in the world and how she was better than everyone else and no one knew soccer better than she did. She would say that she was so good, she didn't even need to practice. She was so good, she didn't even need teammates. Girl number two, on the other hand, knew she didn't know how to play soccer, but she wanted to learn. So she asked other people how to play. She went to practice, she listened to the coach, and she ran drills. That's it. That's the story I want to tell you. So my question to you, who do you think became the better soccer player? Girl number one, who thinks she already knows how to play soccer? Or girl number two, who wants to learn how to play soccer? Awesome. And why do you think girl number two is going to become the better soccer player? Very good. She wants to learn instead of thinking she already knows it all. So in today's scripture story, Jesus tells a story just like the one I told you. But instead of the story being about girls who don't know how to play soccer, Jesus tells a story about two men who don't know how to live God's better way of life. In the story, one man tells God how great of a person he is. And because that man thinks he knows how to live God's way, he keeps telling God while he's praying that he is super great at life, is so much better at life than anyone else. That sounds a lot like the first girl who thought she knew already everything all about soccer, doesn't it? The other man in the story, though, tells God, I need help. I don't know what I'm doing with my life. Help me to live in your better way. Which sounds a lot like the second girl who was always trying to learn more about soccer. So of the two men, who do you think will be able to learn from God about how to live God's better way? Exactly. Why do you think it's number two? Very good. He wants to learn instead of thinking he already knows it all. That's right. And just as importantly, you just said one of the main things that Jesus wants us to understand about ourselves from the story. When we stop thinking that we know it all and instead ask God and others for help, then we will be able to learn and improve. And the things we then learn and receive will also be the things that we can also share with the people around us. And that's the good news for today. Let's pray. This is a repeat after me prayer.
Dear God, please help us to remember,
please help us to
that we don't know it all.
That we don't know it all.
And to ask for and listen.
And to ask for and listen.
For help from you and others.
For help from you and others.
Thank you and amen.
Thank you and amen.
Thanks for coming up today.
And let us join in singing, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. We're going to sing verses 1 and 3. It'll be on the screen, and it's 351 in our hymnal. Some of you may be familiar with the Kenny Rogers song, I'm the Greatest. It goes like this. I'm not going to sing it, so don't get worried. Little boy in a baseball hat stands in the field with his ball and bat, says, I am the greatest player of them all. Puts his bat on his shoulder and he tosses up the ball, and the ball goes up and the ball comes down, swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still he can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. Now the little boy doesn't say a word, picks up his ball, he is undeterred, says, I am the greatest there has ever been. And he grits his teeth and he tries it again, and the ball goes up and the ball comes down, swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still he can hear the sound, the baseball falls to the ground. He makes no excuses, he shows no fear, he just closes his eyes and listens to the cheers. Little boy, he adjusts his hat, picks up his ball, stares at his bat, says, I am the greatest, the game is on the line. And he gives his all one last time. And the ball goes up like the moon so bright, he swings his bat with all his might, and the world's as still can be, and the baseball falls, and that's strike three. Now it's supper time, and his mama calls. Little boy starts home with his bat and ball, says, I am the greatest, and that is a fact, but even I didn't know I could pitch like that. Says, I am the greatest, that is understood, but even I didn't know I could pitch that good. Some of you remember Muhammad Ali, world prize fighter, known for saying what? I am the greatest. The quote, I am the greatest, I'm the greatest thing that ever lived, I don't have a mark on my face, and I upset Sonny Liston, and I just turned 22 years old, I must be the greatest. Upon first hearing our gospel reading today, we might think that it is about us being humble, about not proclaiming that we are the greatest, not bragging that we are better than that other person over there, better than others because of what we have done or not done. In fact, we might even be sitting here and hearing the story of the Pharisee and the tax collector, and in our heads we might be thinking to ourselves, I could never be like that Pharisee. I don't think I'm better than anyone else like he does. I don't put others down like he does. But if that is the case, if that is what we are doing, then I think we miss the point. And in fact, when claiming that we are not like the Pharisee, that the Pharisee is the bad guy, we set ourselves up to be in the very same boat as the Pharisee. Over the years of ministry, I have been asked to define sin. What constitutes a sin? What makes something sinful? Now, I know we joke about chocolate truffles being sinfully delicious. Some of us. Or cookies or ice cream, whatever your weakness is. Or something that tempts us, leading us into sin. But I don't really think, well, I know that chocolate is not sinful. I'm just putting it out there. And do we really think that something that tempts us can lead us to sin? So very simply, without getting into a lot of explanation, without getting into a lot of theology, my definition of sin is anything that leads to us being separated from our need of God, our reliance on God's mercy and grace. It is anything that separates us from God. So with that in mind, hear the prayer of the tax collector. God, show mercy to me, a sinner. Now let's rephrase that. God, show mercy to me as I have been apart, I have separated from you. The Pharisee, on the other hand, seeks to separate himself from those others. The crooks, the evildoers, the adulterers, even tax collectors like that one over there. And in defining everything he has done to separate himself, defining everything he has done to separate himself, everything he has done to make himself right with God, he sets himself up not needing God. He sets himself up as apart, as separate from God's mercy and grace. He sets himself up as the greatest and not needing God at all. He is made right all by himself. It is everything that he has done that makes him righteous, not anything that God has done. He is righteous, but he is by his own determination. He is self-righteous. And this parable, ultimately, it's not about self-righteousness. It's not about humility any more than it is about being pious like the Pharisee or desperate like the tax collector. Rather, this parable is about God. God who alone can judge the human heart. God who determines to justify the ungodly. Because at the end of this story, the Pharisee is going to leave the temple. He's going to return to his home. He is the same self-righteous person that he was when he started. It hasn't changed. He was self-righteous when he came up. He'll be self-righteous when he goes back down. The tax collector, on the other hand, will leave the temple and go back down to his home justified, accounted righteous by God, at God's hand. So how has this happened? The tax collector makes neither sacrifice nor restitution. He doesn't say, I'm not going to be a tax collector anymore. So on what basis, then, is he deemed righteous? It is only on the basis of God's divine grace and mercy, only by the fact that he made room for God's grace and mercy in his life and relied on it rather than his own merit. When we hear this story, it is to remind us that we have nothing to claim but our dependence on God's mercy. When this happens and we forget, if only for a moment, our human constructed divisions, our self-righteousness, when we stand before God, aware only of our own need for grace and mercy, then we too are justified by the God of Jesus. We too are invited to return to our homes in mercy, grace, and gratitude. Amen. And if I could have the ushers begin the presentation of offering and tithes. most gracious God, you give to us so generously. You give to us even more than what we need. We ask that as we bring a small portion of what you have given to us, that we lay it before you today, that it may be acceptable in your sight, and that what we bring before you today may be used to further your will and your word in our world. We ask your blessing in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you forever. Amen. Be seated. Let's see, do we have any birthdays or anniversaries to celebrate this morning? If they do, they're keeping their heads down, so I'm not. And I should say celebrate or commiserate, because it depends on how that goes. Are there joys or concerns that you would like to share this morning? Is everybody awake this morning? Because I'm hearing crickets in my head here. Yes, Kathy. Thank you for having something.
I want to thank you all for your prayers for our son's fiance, Sarah. She does have her surgery to remove the cancer this Tuesday in Chicago. And our son was just here this morning and last night on his way up there to be with her. They did find out it is not genetic, so that's a big praise. The surgery will hopefully be less invasive that way. And they will be up there for probably another couple weeks after the surgery for her to recuperate. So,
okay. Well, we'll certainly keep Sarah right in her in our prayers and her team of doctors and surgeons as they work, and that her recovery will be swift, and that your son will have good travels and be able to be there. Other joys or concerns this morning? Mike, did you ever feel like Phil Donahue running with the mic? Some of you don't get that reference. That was a year or two ago.
I'm asking for prayers for a former co-worker of both my husband and I, Troy Jameson from Bellflower, Illinois. He was electrocuted and died. For his family, they just had the services this weekend, and it's very hard for the family. It was tragic. He was only 56 years old. So
we'll certainly keep that family in our prayers as they grieve. Other joys or concerns this morning? And let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Most gracious and merciful God, we come before you with the concerns of our hearts. For those that we have named, for Sarah who is facing surgery, and for a family who is grieving, you know each situation. We ask for your hand to be upon the surgeons, for Sarah, upon her doctors, and to be upon her as well as she needs strength for healing. We ask that your hand be upon a family that we know is grieving the death of one gone too soon. We know that it is your hand and your action, your words, that come through us as we surround those who grieve. Help them to hear your grace, your mercy, your healing words of love. We give you thanks this day for the joys that we share, the joys of gathering together as family in Christ, for the joy of being together to share the fun and things that happen in the fall. We ask your blessing upon this afternoon as we gather, that where two or three are gathered, we know you will be there. We give you thanks for the birthdays and the anniversaries, for the everyday celebrations that we have, knowing that at all times and all places you are there amongst us, that you share in our celebration. We ask that you be with us in this week to come, that as we face each day, we do so unafraid, knowing that you walk beside us, and that whatever we face, you are there with us. We give you thanks in all things, and we ask now that you hear us as your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And let us stand and turn in the little black book to the Lily of the Valley. It's 2062 in the book. It's also on our screen. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and in Jesus Christ. May the blessing of God Almighty be among you and remain with you always. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen.